Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Collaborative Society by Dariusz Jemielniak and Aleksandra Przegalinska. Narrated by Bruce Mann. 1. Introduction. A stranger on the street asks you for directions. Do you ignore the request or stop to reply? Most of us, unless we're really in a hurry, we'll stop to help, even though we don't get anything for our effort. We react this way because we are extremely social animals. So much so, in fact, that social isolation can elicit distress exceeding physical pain. Also, as humans, we are wired for collaboration. Even 14-month-old infants are inclined to altruistically help others achieve individual goals, and are also willing to cooperate toward a shared goal. Being collaborative distinguishes us as human even more than our opposable thumbs. The drive to cooperate significantly sets us apart from chimpanzees, our closest cousins in terms of DNA similarity, and this difference is already visible in young children. In fact, cooperation with non-kin, so typical for humans, is relatively rare in the animal kingdom. Collaboration may be an evolutionary mechanism that emerged as a result of the way our early ancestors acquired cooperative practices regarding food. Sharing resources seems natural to us. Indeed, much human sharing follows strong social norms of equity and fairness. As Matthew D. Lieberman shows, even our brains react in deeply social and cooperation-oriented ways. We are, in fact, wired to be super-cooperators. Homo sapiens may have evolved via selection for pro-sociality in a process Brian Hare calls the survival of the friendliest. This quite powerful drive to cooperate with others starts early in life. Studies show that the preference for pro-social behavior in humans begins as early as infancy. The desire to help may be intrinsically motivated in children as young as 2 or 3 years old, although, counterintuitive as it seems, extrinsic rewards may undermine that desire. Even so, some research suggests that infants' pro-social behavior is actually governed by basic cost-benefit analyses. This is not to say that as a species, our cooperative behaviors necessarily derive from altruism. Rather, they may stem from mutualistic collaboration, a necessary result of interdependence within a group, which allows for skills specialization. One way or another, though, collaborative behaviors define quite clearly, and to a large extent, what makes us human. But human collaboration is a complex phenomenon. A great deal of capitalistic and neoliberal philosophy relies on positioning people as individualist, and mainly homo economicus, rather than as being interested in participatory culture. Perhaps this is why we've only recently become more attuned to the rise of collaboration, enabled, as it is now, by the development of communication technologies largely independent of traditional organizational structures, procedures, institutions, and hierarchies. This is particularly true when new tech does not impair sociability by supplanting our deeper offline engagement with superficial online engagement, but makes deeper engagement possible in the first place, or complements our existing offline connections. Human collaboration enabled by technology can occur in specific contexts, such as peer production and collaborative consumption, or more generally through online sharing and exchange platforms. Emerging technologies, thanks to their direct collaboration-enabling features, and their engagement of much broader populations, act as super-multipliers for many effects of collaboration that would otherwise be less noticeable. We perceive this phenomenon to emanate from what we call collaborative society. an emerging trend that changes the social, cultural, and economic fabric of human organization through technology-fostered cooperative behaviors and interactions. This budding collaborative society relies on different modes of cooperation, sharing, joint creation, production, distribution, trade, and consumption of goods and services by people, communities, and organizations. Collaborative society can also be viewed as a series of services and startups that enable peer-to-peer exchanges and interactions through technology. Although it may be a relatively recent new technology-enabled phenomenon, collaborative society in its entirety is a system with good old sharing and collaboration at its heart. In fact, cooperation laid the foundation for the internet as we know it today. To the developers of ARPANET, sharing knowledge proved more productive than trading information. Sharing was also understood literally, as the early computer systems were premised on the collaborative use of hardware, and the culture of sending demos and software on floppy drives by mail long preceded online piracy. The hacker ethic, sparked by joining forces in imaginative ways, foregrounded radical openness, decentralization, and collaboration. Most tech developers understood collaboration and peer production broadly as the heart of the net's innovative capacities and viewed encapsulated proprietary networks as limiting them. Marcus Felsen and Joe L. Spaeth, in their study Community Structure and Collaborative Consumption, introduced the term economy of sharing in 1978. Today, more than 40 years later, the economy and society continue to rapidly develop and transform. The significant boost in sharing, as both a work and lifestyle, stemmed from swift improvements in technologies such as social media, mobile technologies, cybercurrencies, and co-production. Some experts, however, predict that this development will soon slow down, even though others argue that it has hardly begun. Juliet Shaw observes that a clear definition of technology-mediated open collaboration might be difficult to pin down. Some already acknowledge sharing as an important term of self-description for digital cultures. But others see the very concepts of open collaboration or sharing economy as still unclear and problematic, because they embody at least half a dozen diverse phenomena: acts of communication, gifting, swapping, distributing, contributing, and digital replication. Some scholars note that sharing is no longer just a mundane practice, but rather an expression of a utopian imaginary associated with politics, with socialist, communist, and anarchist values, with the free culture movement and the digital commons. Notions of sharing and collaboration, however, proliferate in popular discourse and among decision makers. For instance, Italy passed a bill in 2016 that defines the sharing economy as an economic system generated by the optimization and shared allocation of space, time, goods and services through digital platforms. Similarly, the EU Commission defined collaborative economy as a brokerage between individual service providers and recipients. Even more important in the general discourse are the plethora of authors who believe that collaborative economy, particularly commons-based peer production, has the potential to transform the capitalistic system and the whole of society into something much less corporate-driven and more equality-based. Proponents of open collaboration argue that online connectivity allows provisioning based on access rather than ownership, which enables better use of previously underutilized assets like cars, private rooms, apartments, and tools. The thriving marketplace that exists as a result, they say, transfers the burden of maintenance to the provider, while the sharing platform reaps the benefits. At the same time, however, stark critics of the phenomenon insist that collaborative communities based on sharing may be yet another cover for social injustice and user exploitation. With the advent of highly successful corporations that have embraced the collaborative rhetoric, such as Facebook, Uber, or Amazon's Mechanical Turk, the early promises that internet users would be empowered through their participation in creating the online world seem ever more distant, considering the ubiquitous online presence of these companies and their influence on users' lives. For some companies attempting to benefit from the sharing economy, the notion of sharing has become a marketing strategy, thus redefining sharing in the eyes of the millions who partake in these practices. Two examples of sharing economy fallout illustrate this point. First, unionized taxi drivers recently protested that apps such as Uber allow almost anyone with a driver's license to become a de facto taxi driver. But legal challenges in some jurisdictions have established that these people, whom the platform portrays as independent sharers, are actually Uber employees. Second, lobbyists in Airbnb-infiltrated cities like New York City and Berlin have begun to appeal to regulatory and zoning boards to ban short-term rental platforms, often to the joy of the local communities whose rental markets suffer from shortages and inflated prices. Although we believe these discussions to be important, we must point out that the rise of collaborative society extends beyond the phenomenon of the sharing economy or the deconstruction of capitalism. Yes, economic transactions play a role in technology-enabled cooperation, but collaborative society further encompasses the emerging fields of remix culture, peer production, gift economy, citizen science, collaborative media consumption, wearables tracking, and digital communication, all of which alter the very fabric of our societies, but not necessarily, or always, by their transactional character. Looking at this composite picture through a single lens allows us to see the larger, more coherent change that is taking place. Nicholas John compellingly argues that we are entering the age of sharing. We mostly agree, but we believe that the principal weight of the change lies elsewhere. Whereas sharing is an important symptom of the transformation that substantially alters economies and markets, the new modes of technology-enabled interactions and their cooperative character are what make those changes so profound. It is not only the result of the collaboration that matters, but the collective action itself that affects how we grow as a society. Different platforms and business models may come and go, but the collaborative society, with all its monetary and non-monetary aspects, is incessantly on the rise. Once we realize that Airbnb is but a platform for apartment rental, we'll be more open to notice where else the collaborative society revolution strikes, and with much greater impact. Consider Wikipedia, the Pirate Bay, 4chan, Tinder, and Twitter, for instance. While only moderately affecting trade, these repositories redefine not only the traditional knowledge hierarchy, but also our trust in intimacy, matchmaking, and friendship, as well as in public and private communication. Clearly, the consequences of the open collaboration phenomenon surpass recent reforms in capitalism. Although we describe various effects the collaborative economy has had on all our lives, we focus in this book on important social aspects of collaborative society. We are entering an age of networked individualism fostered by perpetual online connectedness. It relies on a highly cooperative collective, irrespective of any financial dimension. Unsurprisingly, the future development of collaborative society likely depends on the performance of big data analytics, the use of machine learning, and the development of the Internet of Things. There remain, however, other significant factors to consider including the future of employment in the context of ongoing automatization and the role of the state in forthcoming regulations, as well as the growing or declining willingness of people to collaborate, help others, and share their values and resources. With this book, we aspire to present a balanced, unbiased view of the collaborative aspects of new technologies, not just another take on collaborative society embedded only in critical theory, but rather a forum to discuss potential future scenarios regarding open collaboration as a social phenomenon. With that in mind, we showcase emerging practices of collaboration as they've occurred in individual communities. To help ground our listeners in our approach to these cases, we define the concept of collaborative society that we adhere to throughout the book. An increasingly recurring phenomenon of emergent and enduring cooperative groups, whose members have developed particular patterns of relationships through technology-mediated cooperation. Although we don't dismiss the major influence collaboration has on capitalism, we prefer to emphasize its impact on other areas, such as culture, intimacy, and relationships. To that end, we organize our book in the following way. In Chapter 2, Neither Sharing Nor Economy, we discuss the key concepts of sharing economy, collaborative economy, platform capitalism, cooperativism, and gig economy. We criticize the persistence of sharing economy as a term in popular and academic discourse by critically analyzing its oversimplistic and fuzzy meaning. We also point to the rhetorical hijacking of the term by many corporations. Although we recognize the explanatory value of the other concepts, we furthermore demonstrate that many aspects of the ongoing major change in society do not necessarily relate predominantly to the economy. Hence, we propose the concept of a collaborative society as a better way to capture the ongoing transformation. With Chapter 3, Peer Production, we present both the narrower view, which perceives peer production as principally commons-based, and the wider perspective that includes commercial initiatives. We describe the ways in which peer production operates, such as its peculiar approach to authority and leadership, its hierarchical structure, and the open participation model. We observe the consequences of consensus orientation and participative decision-making for conflicts, gender balance, and formalization. In addition, we discuss the motivations to participate in peer production, which may include a person's desire to create a portfolio, a professional reputation, and a standing within the community, as well as a desire to do something for the general good and to collaborate with strangers. Then, as we turn to address what happens when producers and consumers of collaborative media become one and the same, or prosumers, we look at the internet as both playground and factory, with the potential for exploitation through unpaid work gamified as fun. In the fourth chapter, Collaborative Media Consumption and Production, we discuss online cooperative initiatives that do not necessarily focus on long-term production of larger works, but rather foster the joint production and consumption of media. We then explore the consequences that the mass participation of amateur creators in collaborative media may impose on our traditional perceptions of professionals, revealing that in some industries, consumers may actually prefer amateur content, while in others, the criteria of what is amateur and professional are definitely not set in stone. Moreover, we explain how collaborative entertainment consumption and production rely on a performative value of collective participation rather than on creating a lasting outcome. In our discussion of memes, we focus both on their comic and social activist manifestations. We consider how new platforms of communication, as well as content creation and redistribution, have stimulated the birth of new social movements in Chapter 5, Collaborative Social Activism and Hacktivism. We discuss the culture of hacktivism and the blend of technological and social focus in its collaborative initiatives. Examples of the anonymous and anti-actor movements show in detail how cyberactivism originated and continues. Finally, we address the criticism of slacktivism and consider the political cyber-terrorism aspects of hacking. In our sixth chapter, Collaborative Knowledge Creation, we begin with a thorough exploration of how trust in general science and authority of academia itself has deteriorated. We furthermore consider the phenomenon of citizen science communities as an emerging new model of collaborative knowledge creation. Then, we discuss their relation to do-it-yourself, DIY science, and biohacking. New communities, working outside the traditional methods and environments of scientific research, but no less determined to make actual discoveries, and to liberate scientific discoveries from the hands of licensed academics. Ultimately, we contrast these communities with alter-science movements, which aim to question the existing knowledge hierarchies by offering knowledge systems based on the beliefs of their members. Continuing the discussion about participative and spontaneous participation in DIY movements and self-tracking in Chapter 7, Collaborative Gadgets, we describe the various uses of widely available tracking technologies. We examine the principles of the quantified self movement and position it within the collaborative society approach. Then we look at various gamification models that rely on wearable trackers and discuss how they affect social behavior. Finally, we refer to the emerging electroencephalography, EEG, self-tracking communities, and discuss the whole concept of collaborative tracking as an idea that could one day replace self-tracking. In our eighth chapter, Being Together Online, we consider how the new internet-intermediated forms of social relations reshape the ways in which people interact. Using the example of the online virtual world accessible in Second Life, we show how fully immersive online games from the past enabled collaboration. We then turn our discussion to how users reposition online platforms for media sharing or dating according to the needs of collaborative society, looking specifically at Instagram, Snapchat, and Tinder tools for cooperation. Thus, we show that collaboration is a default human orientation, further enabled and amplified by online platforms. In our ninth and final chapter, Controversies and the Future of Collaborative Society, we extrapolate from the current trends and observe that collaborative tendencies may not necessarily prevail. We discuss the negative effect of collaborative society's advances, including filter bubbling and fake news. We remark on the dangers and potential of bots and other non-human actors that now enter the collaborative society. But we also discuss being open to their positive capabilities. Finally, we consider the possible impact of intermediating technologies on the future of collaboration. 2. Neither sharing nor economy. Open collaboration, sharing economy, platform capitalism, and peer production all describe certain aspects of a revolutionary change resulting from socio-technological advancement. In this chapter, we briefly describe these concepts and explain why we believe that viewing them through the lens of the collaborative society better suits aspects of their transforming potential, which could otherwise go unnoticed. Open collaboration is a form of organization and cooperation in which participants share a common goal but are loosely coordinated. Yet together, they create a product or service and make the final result available to anyone interested. Open collaboration communities often rely on common discussions, but interactions among their participants are usually optional and depend on the depth and complexity of the collaboration. The idea, which originated in free open-source development circles, is often linked to the GNU Manifesto. Written by Richard Stallman, The document postulated the creation of a Unix-compatible operating system that would be available, free of charge, to use, study, change, and redistribute. The idea worked well, and not just for an operating system. It currently reaches beyond programming, one example being in the open knowledge movement, which directly draws from free open-source culture and tradition. In the late 20th century, many thought that open collaboration initiatives would forever alter nearly every industry and, possibly, change the very nature of capitalism. Indeed, at that time, not only was Linux already a major open-source player dominating the markets of server and smartphone operating systems, but Wikipedia was also easily winning the competition with Britannica, and has since undoubtedly conquered the online encyclopedia niche. Now, however, we clearly see that these successes were isolated, and the utopian idea that all industries would soon follow suit was likely but a dream. Even though there are plenty of promising, growing, and expanding grassroots initiatives, and an open collaboration model in the brick-and-mortar world of manufacturing, none are yet as successful as their commercial counterparts. Moreover, corporations have bit by bit taken back some of the successes of the free, open-source movement. For instance, Linux dominates the smartphone market, but does so in its Android variation, which Google developed in such a way as to promote its own services. Because simple open-source Android comes with few apps and functions expected by contemporary users, such as maps or a modern email client, Google piggybacked on Android's success. It effectively forced nearly all Android phone producers to pay for a Google-branded Android bundle license, which brings Google Maps, Gmail, and Play Store to the table. In other words, Google exploited the system and reversed its openness, thus reducing it to a freemium platform. Similarly, even though Wikipedia does not have much direct competition, Google reuses vast amounts of the online encyclopedia's content in the right sidebar of Google searches, also known as the Knowledge Graph panel. In many cases of commercial reuse of Wikipedia, especially in the increasingly popular voice interfaces, users rarely know that the answers to their questions come from Wikipedia. Such use, which may deter readers from accessing the site if the Google sidebar applied sufficient information, significantly limits not only Wikipedia's ability to raise funds, but also to attract new users. Introducing new users is essential to the site for several reasons. Because only a typically small fraction of Wikipedia readers volunteer to write and edit its entries, and there is a natural burnout. And because volunteer engagement in crowdsourced movements escalates slowly, through gradually increased participation. Overall, commercial enterprises adapted to the free, open source, and open collaboration environment by taking advantage of them rather than giving much back, or by sharing whatever benefits they received as a result of using the openly developed goods. Two recent acquisitions, first of GitHub by Microsoft, and second of Red Hat by IBM, the latter for a mind-blowing sum of $34 billion, also show that traditional corporations not only adjust to peer production as a source of free labor, but also appreciate platforms that allow for free software development and collaboration. The abuse of sharing. The term used for new phenomena associated with open collaboration, sharing economy, sometimes referred to as collaborative economy, has become a buzzword today, possibly the most recognizable term related to the processes of open collaboration. It has yielded about 7 million results in a Google search as of May 2019, thanks to the seemingly ubiquitous coverage in mainstream media about the commercial success of Uber, Airbnb, and similar platforms, and also as a result of the term's prevalent use in academia. Quite clearly, however, the name is doubly misleading. As we show in this chapter, what many often call sharing economy is neither about sharing nor just about the economy. In this section, we offer a brief typology of commonly used terms related to the topic and categorize them based on the monetary or non-monetary orientation of platforms and users. Let's begin by looking into the premise behind sharing. As we commonly understand it, sharing involves no monetary exchange. This is certainly true of Linux or OpenStreetMap, but clearly not of Uber or Airbnb. Here's an example of sharing from everyday life to further illustrate our point. If two roommates use the same hairdryer, they share. If one of them wants to charge the other for the privilege, we can safely predict that this refusal to share is likely to change the dynamic between the roommates. On this basis, we can argue that corporations such as Airbnb or Uber undermine the pre-existing sharing culture in many aspects. Think about how the bottled water industry put a price tag on what was previously perceived as a common good. Airbnb and Uber, for their part, have approved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.